Clinic, as we talked before, so me, I'm Clemente. I work at the Barcelona Clinic, the schizophrenia unit, and in charge of the early onset psychiatric unit from our area, which is about 1,500,000 people population. And I will be talking in the next 20 minutes about the novel pharmacological treatment for treatment-resistant schizophrenia. Okay, before we start talking about treatment, I will try to remind ourselves that we are talking about schizophrenia, which is far away from an homogeneous disease. It's quite a heterogeneous disease. I think this is a resume of articles published in schizophrenia research, what we know after 20 years of research in schizophrenia. And I think that the best thing they did there is they try to resume schizophrenia as a title of blind Indians that you see below. Schizophrenia can be resembled as this fable because mostly whenever we see every part of the diagnosis of schizophrenia, when we talk about positive symptoms, we may be thinking it's a psychosis due to substance abuse. When we talk about negative symptoms, we may be talking about pervasive developing disorders. When we talk about cognitive deficit, we may be speaking about any type of dementia. And when we talk about affective symptoms, we may be thinking sometime about major depression disorder or bipolar disorder. So the concept of the fable is different blind people touch an elephant, and depending on the part of the elephant they touch, they believe it's a different animal. So those maybe resembles much better the concept of schizophrenia as a quite heterogeneous disease. And that's important because besides the fact that we don't know much about the global overall outcome of schizophrenia, like what Joe Gomiton explained before, it hasn't changed mostly in the last 60 years, actually. What we know for sure is more or less the evolution of the course of the schizophrenia, even the fact that we have used in the last year different type of pharmacological treatment to improve it. So we do have a premolar and premolar phase, that's mostly why early onset psychosis units were built about 20 years ago in England and in Australia, trying to detect the symptoms before the onset, which is quite difficult nowadays, but still sometimes we have those at-risk mental state patients that we'll see later some type of treatment we will be using on them. Then we do have a first onset of psychosis, and then depending on different, like we saw before, different adverse events of different risk factors, we may have a deterioration course with an residual and stable phase over time. And that's even before the use of diverse pharmacological treatment that may improve the overall outcome. For that reason, and also for the morbidity and mortality of schizophrenia, we do have schizophrenia between the 20 most disabled diseases worldwide, which is quite important for a disease that more or less has a prevalence of 1% in all the populations in the world. So, due to the treatment, actually we didn't have much before the 50s, which was the first time chlorpromazine was first used in a psychiatric asylum in the outskirts of Paris. And that's quite important because it starts for the first time that patients who got admitted in a psychiatric hospital in that time, or a psychiatric asylum, maybe in the outskirts of the big cities, for the first time the patient was discharged after 2-3 weeks. So that's the first time a patient is able to get back into a society and try to start a new life, or at least keep up with his previous life. Since the introduction of chlorpromazine, we have been trying to deal with diverse pharmacological treatments, mostly related with dopamine 2 antagonists. So the main issue is that we are trying nowadays to focus in different type of treatments far from dopamine 2 antagonists because we have seen that the outcome has not much improved with this type of treatment. So in next year, we'll probably see what we see later on are different type of treatments related with other type of pharmacological receptors, mostly related with glutamine, glutamatergic receptors, and nicotine, that we may over time improve the outcome that so far we haven't been able to improve. So the main key question when we talk about schizophrenia is that we have between 20 and 30% of the patients who take their medications are treatment to resistant to those dopamine 2 antagonists. And those are the type of patients that are called treatment resistant schizophrenia patients. They usually have diverse type of their, depending on the criteria we look after, there are different types, but mostly are patients who they have a good prognosis, they have a bad functioning over the last 5 years. We have been using two type of different family treatments regarding dopamine 2 antagonist treatment, or for a certain amount of time, usually over 6 weeks and over still have positive symptoms like hallucinations, disorientation, suspiciousness, or delusion. And those are the patients that we call them treatment-resistant schizophrenia. And for those patients, usually, from a pharmacological point of view, and at the moment, we only have one treatment, this clozapine. Besides being a D2 with a receptor antagonist, clozapine is supposed to have most of the positive outcomes coming through because of the D4 and D2 and D3 receptor antagonists. However, still clozapine, the doctor, Mitunen may know much better than we, that clozapine was taken on withdrawal from the market in 1972 due to anomalocytosis in Finland. They died up to nine patients. And it was later on included into the market in 1989, mainly because we knew that there was no other better treatment to use in our patients. But besides that, although clozapine is the gold standard, still we do have a certain amount of patients, let's say about 50 of them, that even if they are on clozapine, they usually don't have an improvement. So what can we do with those patients? Can we tell them, keep calm, patient, take your clozapine? No. For those patients are the ones that you have been developing in the last 20 years, whatever you call the novel pharmacological treatment for resistant schizophrenia. Mostly related with glutamate receptors, nicotine receptors. There are some clinical trials that we see about anti-inflammatory treatment. Even nutrition intervention that maybe in the last couple of years have been becoming much more important. And I would like to talk at the end about what I will call a paradoxical treatment for treatment resistant schizophrenia patients. When we talk about glutamate has been a receptor mostly described in the psychiatric literature since we understood that phenylcycline, which is a drug, mimics the, which is a drug that will be as is an antagonist of the glutamate receptor, mimics perfectly the symptomatology of patients with schizophrenia. Glutamate is the major central nervous system excitatory neurotransmitter. It's primarily located in cortical pyramidal neurons. It has corticosteroid and thalamocortical projections, and glutamate mechanisms are important for almost all the central nervous system activities, from neuroplasticity, neurocommunication, memory formation, learning, and regulation. I will focus in two types of treatments, mostly glutamatergic agents that directly affect the glutamate receptor, and also for adjunctive glutamatergic agents for clozapine non-responder, lamotrigine, which most of you may use in your practice, like minocycline, which is something that at least we don't use it so often. The NLRP3 aspartate receptor released inside has been probably one of the primary targets that were used in the pharmacological industry in order to treat or to act on treatment for resistant schizophrenia. However, they did not make much improvement, actually. This is probably one of the biggest, or the last biggest clinical trials, about 150 patients conducted by our colleagues in Maryland, Buchanan and Carpenter, American Journal of Psychiatry 2007. Patients going for design, disiproseran, and placebo, and which has served no positive outcomes regarding those releasing receptor and agonist. Later on, there come a couple of studies, mostly also for a group from MGH, Massachusetts General Hospital, Donald Goff, which tried not only to focus on the specific effects of disiproseran or other type of releasing receptors on positive symptoms, but mostly on cognitive and negative symptoms. This is a study about 30 patients. We have some outcome related with cognition. However, it did not exert a large effect. And the last clinical trial that has been ongoing was published last year. This is DC one weekly, 30 patients, cognitive regulation in schizophrenia, the same group from the MGH. And the main outcome of this was, besides using on those patients a non-pharmacological treatment, which is cognitive remediation, the outcome on the add-on with D-ciproseran was not a real large effect size. So we still have to gather more data in order to think that NMDA receptor releasing site is a good target for improving cognitive and negative symptoms in schizophrenia. We meet, this is another, besides the one, this was another like last shot from the receptor. It's 200 patients from a study combined with Israel and the state. We did not exert much positive results, mainly because they have an increased amount of improvement on the cognition and the placebo group, starting with some of their other clinical trials that we present. We do have another receptor, which is the AMPA kinase, which are positive allosteric modulators. First study was in the beginning of the 2000. This is about 200 patients with CX516 at atuglosamine. At that time, they have some improvement, not only in cognitive, but also in negative symptoms. However, they did have 2008, which did not assert any type of improvement overall. So that AMPA kind of line has been more or less closed for future research. This is two of the molecules that we're presenting now. Sartosin, which has been is a using T1 receptor reuptake inhibitor. It has in the last year some interesting results. First is a case report for 2014, where they say a patient with schizophrenia who was getting 2 grams of Sartosin every day, and that patient was on treatment with ketamine and citalopram and improved some symptoms and actually almost got into an hypomanic state, which is quite interesting to understand. It failed mainly because it was under treatment with ketamine and citalopram. They reduced the dose to 1 gram of Sartosin, and the patient showed some improvement, obviously, in cognitive and negative symptoms. This is 2015, a clinical trial with Sartosin for 30 patients, and they do exert some improvement after 1 week of treatment in the overall symptomatology, which is probably one of the most promising treatments that we do have nowadays for treatment-resistant patients with schizophrenia. This is one of the probably that you may have here in the last year. This is RG1678, more known, most well known as Itopertin. Itopertin was probably 5 years ago one of the stars of the negative symptoms supported by Roche. Roche was developing this molecule, and I bet some of you may have been involved in the clinical trials. Almost 300 patients worldwide. It was this presentation of this article in 2014 where they showed there has been interesting results regarding negative and cognitive symptoms. However, unsurprisingly, about 3 or 4 months later, Roche suspended all the clinical trials from Itopertin worldwide, mainly because they said they had not got into the expected outcome with the positive and negative symptoms that they were expecting, even besides that they had this publication where there were some promising results. This is one of the last molecules we were talking about, benzoyl D-amino acid oxidase. This treatment has been used in the last year in a couple of studies. This is the last one in 2013. Some improvement after 1 week of treatment in positive and negative symptoms. So far, there have not been more studies on the PubMed, but I guess it may be with Sartosin the only other molecule related with the glutamatergic receptor that may have some improvement over time. Then we go to two molecules that you may be using at least from a clinical point of view, lamotrigine, in your clinical practice. Lamotrigine has had some studies suggesting that it will be a good add-on treatment for clozapine. This is the resume of the meta-analysis from Jared Tihonen in 2009, where they showed that there was an improvement overall in the patients which were treated with clozapine and then were add-on treatment with lamotrigine between 25 and 200 milligrams a day. However, later on come a couple of studies. This is a study from 30 patients from some colleagues in Turkey who said that the lamotrigine augmentation did not show results in the patients with clozapine treatment. Despite that, there was another report of 5 cases from Japan that says that in 2 of those patients, the add-on treatment of lamotrigine did not make any results. However, in the other 3 patients were patients with mostly positive symptoms, auditory hallucination, they exert some type of improvement. Lamotrigine, one of the few ones that at least I have experience because we can use it on a regular basis, when we describe that in a clinical history. And my personal experience is probably like the Japanese people, some patients do improve some treatment, some of the outcomes overall, but not, I mean, it's not probably something that we can tell to our fellow clinical psychiatrists that use it when clozapine But there is some evidence that you may have described in your clinical history, say, where you put lamotrigine into your patients.
The last one we were talking regarding glutamatergic receptors is minocycline. Minocycline is a tetracycline antibiotic, most well known because if you are 15, 16 years old and you have acne, they give you minocycline. It's mostly an antibiotic related with dermatological problems. And since 2007, we have a couple of case reports regarding the improvement in the oral symptomatology of patients with schizophrenia taking an add-on treatment with minocycline. Since then, there have been a real amount of articles, even at a meta-analysis in 2014, suggesting that minocycline may have important results for oral symptomatology, positive, negative, general scores in patients with schizophrenia. There were also some other case reports in add-on with clozapine. These are for the colleagues that we were talking before, Romerian, Buchanan, and Carpenter, that they described first some cases regarding improvement in the outcome with minocycline and clozapine patients. And afterwards, they did undergo a clinical trial with adjunctive minocycline in patients with clozapine. However, the overall clinical symptomatology did not improve, but they showed some partial improvement in cognition with minocycline. It's still a molecule that maybe have more interest data in the future, so let's see what it can end up with this.
Let's move into nicotine. Nicotine is an alkaloid found naturally in tobacco, plants, tomatoes, potatoes, first synthesized at the end of, at the beginning of the 20th century.
It's involved in attention, cognition, recognition, vigilance, rewarding mechanism. Nicotine receptors are present almost in all the central nervous system, and as I assume our colleague may speak later about tobacco and schizophrenia. At least for now, we know the administration of nicotine or nicotinamide produced a small but very consistent improvement in a specific cognition domain overall patients and controls. We don't know yet if that has to be related directly with the concept of schizophrenia or if it produces in every patient or in every person worldwide. But still, nicotine is an interesting target for treatment-resistant schizophrenia.
I will present two clinical trials with different outcomes. This is the first clinical trial of 500 people. Alpha-7 nicotine receptor agonist, and as you may see, there are no conclusive results compared with placebo. This is 2015 for this year, and this is another placebo-controlled study of N-cycline, alpha-7 nicotine acetylcholine receptor agonist, cognitive impairment in schizophrenia, and as you may see, there are some improvements in the matrix cognition, not in the top state, but also in the advanced cognitive impairment. Okay, so again, we still see some improvement in the overall clinical outcome of the patients, most related with cognition, but we don't see really if this is going to be the answer to those patients who are very resistant. Oh, sorry.
One few slides. Prostaglandins and anti-inflammatory agents. Since the 60s, we know that there are some authors that start describing that probably there is some concept of some pathway related with inflammation in schizophrenia. This is from 1975, describing the concept of inflammation in prostaglandins and schizophrenia. And that idea has been on the basis of diverse clinical trials regarding anti-inflammatory agents.
I will talk about the first, about the three ones that really show an improvement in the meta-analysis. Aspirin has been a couple of studies that show that the overall outcome of the overall improvement is more is better than placebo compared with placebo. Then we have N-acetylcysteine, that's also an improvement compared with placebo. And for last, we have strobins. Strobins, however, as you may recall, Erling already described at the beginning of the 20th century that there was a hypoestrogenic phenotype in women with schizophrenia. So we all probably, from a theoretical point of view, understood that maybe some type of improvement with the treatment with estrogens. Then we do have a couple of three other molecules that didn't show positive results. Amlodipine
some authors regarding the same concept of anti-inflammatory agents, also using lipid profile lowering agents on ondansetron, which is a 5-HT3 serotonin antagonist receptor, mostly used for nausea and chemotherapy. And there have been some theoretical background regarding the importance of those receptors in schizophrenia. However, this pilot study did not show any important outcome compared with the treatment as usual. A few lines regarding nutritional interventions in schizophrenia. I think this is something that we may be starting to see more and more in the next years, as we may see now there is an interest in microbioma and schizophrenia regarding also with inflammation. You may think it's quite new, but now with consumption and schizophrenia has been on the market for almost 60 years. Those probably were the origins of this concept of, depending on what you eat, you may increase or not a pro-inflammatory circumstance or pro-inflammatory pathways in your body that will end up affecting the outcome of your symptomatology. With consumption was related with schizophrenia in the States after World War II. It actually makes sense in the concept that we do have an increase of antibodies in patients with schizophrenia. Some patients may speak with you and say, now that we do have, for whatever reason, a vegan diet or gluten-free diet, we do feel some improvement. So there is some background regarding this concept. And I will also try to speak just briefly about omega-3 acids. Omega-3 acids, not for overall treatment of schizophrenia, but this is a clinical trial from 5 years ago when patients at risk of mental state who were given omega-3 acids did not make the transition to cetosis with numerine to 3-4, which is a quite important effect. So still that nutritional intervention may not be an important issue, it may have some interest in the overall outcome of patients with schizophrenia. And I would like to close this speech with giving you this concept of the biological intervention that I explained before. This was a brainstorming in the European College of Neuropsychopharmacology this year in Berlin. It was conducted by two other authors that have been named in the previous clinical trials, Mike Weiser and Michael Robinson, and Louis Dantehan. And they spoke about the fact that what about if we treat patients which are resistant to any type of pharmacological treatment? If they are on clozapine, they may be obesity, they may be on high dose of clozapine, and they don't respond properly to the treatment. What happens with those patients? Are we, from an ethical point of view, able to reduce the dose or even take away the treatment because we are getting them with secondary side effects? And that's more or less the concept of this work brainstorm session where they believe that the company will be doing a clinical trial. Problem is who is going to support the clinical trial. But it will be an interesting question in treatment resistant schizophrenia patients that we know that we don't have any type of solution if it's possible to reduce the dose or even take away the treatment in order to avoid secondary side effects. That's all. Thank you very much for your attention. Trials, at least in Europe. I guess in the States they are doing a little much better, but all the not about directly clinical trial, but we'll speak about more from the theoretical point of view. But also in the future, I guess, will be one of the pathways that we're going to start looking at.
Regarding the inflammation of schizophrenia,
yes.
For me, it's not as clear as major depression, because at least for this major compatibility complex genes, you often find even in bipolar disorder a downregulation. I mean, besides these deletions that you get on chromosome 6, you actually find downregulation. It was shown in many studies with huge numbers, at least on the microRNA level, so the transcript level, that you have a downregulation. So actually this treatment against neuroinflammation, do you also see sometimes negative effects that the symptoms are worsening because this balance is really happening?
I will explain you what it first from the speaker, then I will give you my opinion.
Okay.
The clinical studies with anti-inflammatory agents, they show, they didn't show any worsening outcome.
Okay.
However, my opinion, I'm mostly involved in tracking research in patients with schizophrenia, also major depression disorder and bipolar disorder, and we all find out, and I think other also have already done that, there's an inflammation pathway mostly on the major psychiatric illnesses. However, we don't really know how to correlate that with clinical symptomatology. I think trying to correlate inflammation, even peripheral inflammation, because we're not talking about central nervous system inflammation. If we are far away from trying to get inside of the brain, we are correlating peripheral inflammation with clinical symptomatology. Although I've done that in the articles, my concept now is to move toward the fact that there is, in some patients, there is a pathway towards inflammation. Maybe there are some ideas probably due to abnormal early growth in utero, other type of difficulties and early life stressful events, and that can be more specific in major psychiatric illness. So I think we're far away from I understand that it's probably schizophrenia, as we do have the main problem with treatment resistance, that's what gathers most these anti-inflammatory agents or any type of clinical trial. And as depression or bipolar disorder has a much better outcome regarding treatment, I don't think we don't get so far in adding on doing clinical trials with major depression disorder or bipolar. That's my concept. So I think we're far away from trying to focus on inflammatory agents in schizophrenia. It's a much wider concept of the pathway that are related with major psychiatric illness. But that's my concept.
Brain,
what
I was talking about
this
postmortem tissue studies,
so
you have some
of the circulatory
patient actually very much down.
Yeah.
So, I mean,
maybe because they have been afterwards, after years, evolution of the inflammation pathways between glia and the brain. I mean, the main problem we do have is trying to correlate peripheral signs of inflammation to central nervous system. I think that's goes far away from our knowledge so far. I don't know if in the future we'll know, but so far, I think it's far away. Yes?
Would it be useful, I guess, for some inflammatory biomarkers in the most resistant group of patients? Say, for example, tumor necrosis factor or C-reactive protein, etc.
Yeah, actually, some of the clinical trials has been trying to elucidate if those anti-inflammatory treatments that we are using in clinical trials may be more interesting to do a preclinical evaluation of those patients, see who are inflammatory, and then do the treatment of those ones. I'm aware of a couple of any grant that's been this year submitted related to the fact that maybe we are missing the target in clinical trials and we're giving anti-inflammatory agents to everyone. And it doesn't make sense that you give an anti-inflammatory agent to someone who has no inflammatory pharmacology. So I totally agree that TNF-alpha, diverse type of glycemic markers may be more interesting to look at before the onset of clinical trials in order to really improve the outcome, because we're maybe saying that some of the COX-2 has no results, and it may be because for whatever reason, selection bias, those patients that were on a clinical trial in contrast with the patients that were on a clinical trial with aspirin, they were more inflammatory for whatever reason. So that's...
There's an interesting parallel with depression. In depression, I think testing for celiac protein can help you decide between certain antidepressants.
Mm-hmm.
So I suppose that could be a similar parallel here.
For my personal point of view, the inflammatory pattern that appears in all the major psychiatric illness has to have any type of reflection in the clinical symptomatology, even if it's bipolar, major depression, and schizophrenia. Again, I think all the clinical trials with these molecules has been ongoing for schizophrenia, mainly because in major depression we still do have a much better outcome with the treatments. So when we don't have anything, well, it's like the colleagues that said, okay, maybe we can take away the treatment. So if we don't have anything, then we look after things. One of the main keys, anti-inflammatory, because, I mean, since 1970s, we know there is prostaglandin, indomethacin, and schizophrenia, and some kind of connection. So I agree with you in the fact that also major depression, which is the other